Okay, so we were looking yesterday about the pole zeros. We will come back quickly for some few minutes about that again.
Okay.
If you take an arbitrary function x plus j y, the phase of this function will be tan inverse y by x. Please remember what I am saying. I am taking an arbitrary function f is equal to x plus j y. Then the phase for this function is tan inverse y by x, and we call that as a phase angle theta. And we can see substitute some values. If y is x, tan inverse 1 is 45. If y is 0, tan inverse 0 is 0. And if x is y is very large, in closing to tens and hundreds, tan inverse infinity is 90 degrees. So it approaches 90 degree, it does not reach 90 unless it is infinite. But to say it, that means one can say y is large, the phase is 90. If y is 0, phase is 0, and if y is 1, y is equal to x essentially what I mean, then it is 45. Okay. So you can see the phase will vary from where to where, from 90 towards 0 degree as the omegas vary, okay, as the frequency, let us say similarly we can write omega by omega 0. So as the frequency changes, and you can see for every 10 times the frequency, the phase shifts by how much? 45 degree. Okay. You can do 45 for this, 0.1 is very small, so 0, 10 is very large, so 90. So you can say what was the gain function was changing with frequency? 20 dBs per decade. And what is the way phase will change? 45 degree per decade. So every times the frequency changes by 10 times, the phase will go down by 45 degree and gain will also go down by 20 dB. Is that okay? So this is something you should realize, that every gain fall, okay, will be associated with phase going down. Okay. So from 90 to 0 it will actually run down, and typical figure which for a what we call as a phase diagram, phase response is this. Is I am plotting theta versus frequency. So different frequencies, you have phase. So what are these points? These points are the same points at which gain was changing from say 20 dB to 20 plus 20, 40 dB plus 40 dB. So every time it falls 20 dB per this, phase also will follow. Is that clear? And that is this together, and same corner frequencies as they were together, this amplitude diagram, that is the magnitude in dBs and phase in theta, is called Bode's plots. Okay, these two are together called Bode's plots. Please remember, we actually should do as asymptotic values real life, but since we are not interested in how much exactly at this frequency, otherwise we want to know from where it falls, where it becomes 0, those two or three major frequencies we want to know. So these were called corner frequencies, and Bode suggested that for any stability, as we shall see later, the things we want to know, what are the corner frequencies. By mathematics, the day one, what are these corner frequencies we said? They represent poles, the transfer function. That is, transfer function becomes infinite at that value of frequency. Okay. We did not talk in this so far anything about zeros. Okay, we did not talk it. So a simple case can be thought. Let us say I have a pole, let us say magnitude some function, and it has a pole somewhere here at some frequency we call omega p1. And let us say at the same point I have also a 0, that is the numerator also becomes 0 at the same frequency some reason. Okay. Then from here up to this it will be same, and 0 will be actually going plus 20 dB because it is numerator, so the value will increase 20 dB per decade. This is minus 20 dB per decade. So after omega 1 p 1 equal to omega, or which is I am using same, what will be the actual gain? Actual gain will remain constant. Is that idea clear to you? 0 means the numerator, and if you do same thing as we did for pole, every decade of frequency the gain will increase by 20 dB. For a pole it will decrease 20 dB down. So from this frequency onward, plus 20 and minus 20 will keep cancelling per decade. Is that clear? Is that clear? But let us say there is only single 0 here, and there is another pole occurs here, which is say omega p2, and there is no other 0 then. So what is the slope of this? Can anyone tell me? Is the second pole down? Minus 20 for this, plus another 20 from the other pole, so it is minus 40 dB per decade. But that means at this frequency gain will start, because this 0 will actually put it to 20 dB per decade all the time. But what is the gain falling now here? Minus 40 dB. So the together if I do it, then from this point onward you will have minus 20 dB per decade. Is that point clear? I repeat, I have one 0 and one pole at the same frequency, so they compensate. The word is compensate, okay. 0 compensates pole, or also in other word, 0 nulls the pole. Null means cancels, okay. It nulls the pole. This is called pole 0 compensation. This is why I am showing you this initially, because I want to tell you we want to actually increase gain for higher bandwidths. So there are possibilities in which the pole, what is the bandwidth essentially means? What is the definition of a bandwidth I give? Till which the gain is constant. From this frequency down the gain is not, if there is no 0, gain would have fallen. So this is our initial bandwidth. But if you have a 0, this will continue, bandwidth is increasing. So if I cancel a pole, I have actually increased the bandwidth. But at this point, since the 2 poles and 1 0 are occurring onward, the gain will start falling from here itself. How many dB? Minus 20 dB per decade. So what is the new bandwidth now? Omega p2, because beyond that only gain will start falling. So by circuit way, if a device is fixed, I do not have play on that, but I can have now a circuit. If I can create my choice zeros and poles, okay, then I can tailor my frequency response of an amplifier. Is that point clear? By deciding where should I have my poles and zeros, of course they will be limited by the intrinsic property of the transistor, how much is GM, how much whatever biasing you did. But apart from them, whatever is normal amplifier I had, I can monitor, I can add some RCs somewhere, some way. So RC is pole, 1 upon RC is the frequency of a pole or time constant. So if I add or do something, a RC time constant additionally by external part on mine, I will be able to change the bandwidth. Is that point clear? So something you have to understand, that circuit people are always smarter enough, okay. Even if they are working in an adverse circumstance, they may still be able to give you something which you are looking for, okay. Is that clear? This is something, tricks of their trade in all analog designs. Now question is, why you have to solve so many problems in analog? Because for every circuit you are given, their poles will be different, their GMs will be different. So for every one of them you will have to think, redo it again. Is that correct? This does not happen in digital hardware. Why? Because once a gate is a XOR gate or a NAND gate or a NOR gate, do whatever, it will remain that function irrespective. Is that clear? In analog this does not happen, and therefore it is challenging in a way that every problem you have to take it independently. There is no some, of course theory is correct, rules are known, but you will have to solve for every case to do something what you are asking for. So there is no standard design available, okay, I want an op amp of this kind, so oh just buy it from somebody. It is not like that. For that require, I will have to redesign all of it. You say something change, I will have to redo it again, okay. That is why analog designs or analog circuit are much more interesting, if I say otherwise, than the digital. So is that why we are doing all this? Because we should be able to tailor our bandwidth for the use. Someone wants to use that 100 megahertz. What do? I have only one circuit and I have to play games on that. Okay. So there are tricks which you should be able to know, and we will see there are not one, there are three kinds. But when we do all this, there is another term which we will add later, which is called stability. This word we shall come little later after feedbacks, and we will say if you do some mischief otherwise the way I have shown you, it may lead to unstable situations. Okay, and we will see why they are called unstables. Okay. So it is not that you can do randomly anything and get away. You know, you have to suddenly you find amplifier is not giving constant gains or signals are shooting like left and right. Okay. So this stability is another parameter, and that time we say we will use another theory which is feedback. Okay. To stabilize a circuit I may use feedback at the cost of something. And I may use some zero pole compensation technique or something to improve the bandwidth even then, but something I may lose in doing all of it. Is that correct? So please remember, there is nothing, there is no free lunch as we say, or there are no free lunches. Same in circuit, you cannot achieve something greater unless you give somewhere something. Okay. So at every point, what is at stake that is asked for, and what then I can give you, okay, if you do not mind here, then I will give you this. So this is what analog designs are of interest to everyone, because they are, you have to keep thinking this spec should not go too low which is demanded by them, or it should not, still you want employees say, okay, if you give me 10% here, I will give 50%, accept it like this. So there are design issues which this course, as I say, we are not really looking into, but I just want to give perspective of this course. Why are we doing this analysis so many times? Because at the end I have to design somewhere a hardware for them. Okay, that is electronic engineer's job, that we should be able to design a system for them. It may go on finally on a single chip, that is another issue, but design has to be first formed. Okay. And therefore, the tricks of analysis must be known to actually design a hardware. Okay. That is why we are actually looking into theory much seriously. Okay. Okay. So having told you, we have discussed first day one pole circuit. Here is another circuit. Okay, so how many capacitances were there in our first circuit? One capacitance. So how many poles it gave? One, because one RC time constant gives me one pole. Is that clear? We have not yet discussed zero. We will see how zeros appear, but right now we are only looking into poles. Now I have another circuit in mind in which we have two poles. Why two poles? I say, how many capacitance should I have for two poles? Two capacitance, two time constants I must be able to create to have two poles. So here is a circuit which is called a two pole circuit. I have an input source which has a series resistance RS, and I put another capacitance CS in series to this. This S really is series word. Okay. Then there is a resistance RP which is in parallel shunted by a capacitance CP. Okay. Is that okay? A simple circuit. There in one time what we do, either we had this or we had this. Now I have put both of them. CS and CP are both present simultaneously. Is that okay? Is the word clear? Both capacitances are simultaneously present with two resistances. Okay, this is a simple network once again. So if I solve V0 by Vn, I can solve as we did earlier. How do I solve? Take a parallel combination of this, take a series combination of this, then what is V0? This upon this plus this into Vn. Is that correct? What is it equivalent to saying? Z1, of course you should not say resistance, Z1, Z2. This is V0, this is Vn. So V0 is Z2 upon Z1 plus Z2 into Vn. Is that okay? So I calculate this, I calculate parallel combination of this, and then just take a ratio of that, it is called potential divider. Okay, just divide it and you will get V0 by Vn as the transfer function. And what is the transfer function? Here we are looking, it is a voltage gain. Why is called voltage gain? Because V by V, output by input voltage. So the transfer function here is AVS, and why I am talking of this S word? Because it's a frequency dependent term. Capacitance into S is the 1 upon CS is the impedance of a capacitance, or rather CS is called admittance of the capacitance. Okay. So if I do this V0 by Vn, and if I define two time constant, tau S is RS plus RP into CS, this S is subscript, okay, otherwise it will, it is a subscript, okay, or maybe I should rewrite CS, and the other is RS parallel RP times CP. Do you get the point why this, how this parallel combination will come? If I see a resistance from the CP side, what is the resistance CP will see? When I see from output, what should I do? Vn should be grounded. So this RSCS will come into parallel, and for the resistance that will occur, if you separate the terms, it will be essentially coming from that circuit. Okay. So this is the two time constants I have defined. One is RS plus RP into CS, the other is RS parallel RP into CP. Why I define from there? Because I am seeing those functions here, so I define it from there. Okay. So then I write this as a function. So how many, could you see this is a quadratic S term is appearing? This is S square, this is S plus this, is that correct? This into S, 1 plus S square tau P tau S plus 1 plus all this into S tau S. So there is a S square plus S square plus B S plus C is in denominator. Is that clear? Can you write such functions which I did earlier? For example, if I have a function S square plus A S plus 1, let us say, I can always write this as S plus S 1, S plus S2. Of course, this may become some different value because when you connect it, oh no, not right now, it will be 1, but if you want to separate, what is the way you can separate these two functions? By partial fractions. If necessary, you can remove, put a partial fraction. Right now, one can find this is equivalent of, this can see S square into S1S plus S2S into S1S2, okay, and divide S1S2. So you will get some kind of similar expression. So maybe B here. Plus C here. So I can see any such quadratic term in denominator can also be represented as this. If I take S1, S2 outside, then I can write S upon S1 plus 1, S upon S2 plus 1. You can also write this. Is that correct? Please remember S1, S2 are constants, so I can take them out, and then I can get a function which is 1 plus S is omega. S1 will be also in terms of another omega. So 1 plus omega by omega 1 plus into 1 plus 1 plus omega by omega 2 kind of function I can create if I have a transfer function denominator of this form. Is that clear? So whenever there are two capacitance, what, how many poles it will give? Two poles. Is that correct? S square term appearing will always give you two poles. Is that clear? So this fact has to be understood. Whenever there are two time constants involved, there will be two poles. Please remember, it may also create a zero, which in this there is, I am avoiding, there is no equivalent source I have put to create a zero for that, but I can see I can add a zero also by some other trick. Okay, but right now assume that there are no zeros here. So this fact has to be understood. As soon as you write the transfer function and you get a S square terms in the denominator, S square plus S plus something, you can always represent it, this as a product of two such S plus kind of terms, and they say there are two poles S1 and S2 may occur. Is that clear? This is the method of solving any circuit, any transfer function. Now why I say any? Because it is voltage by voltage. Tomorrow it may be voltage by current, third time it may be current by voltage or current by current, or it can have a mechanical system, velocity, force connected. It can always, this is the control system part. Anything has a transfer function, output by input. What is the stimuli? Stimuli, you understand? Any energy source you put, any stimuli is immaterial for us. Okay. Transfer function has nothing to do with voltage, current or something. It can be true for every one of them. However, in our case, we are only looking into electrical functions. Is that okay? So this technique is universal. Is that correct? This technique is? Yes. Okay. If S is j omega, so j omega by S1 will be constant. So 1 plus j omega by S1. Now you can find its magnitude and pole very easily. Is that correct? When you want to find a magnitude, it will be much easier for me to do that. Is that, this is a no compulsion, you can do otherwise, but then also that term will come out finally when you do that. So instead I did initially, okay. I am not telling that this has to be done, but this will come anyway. So I showed you it is much easier to start with like this, okay. Please do not take it that this is has to be done. As long as you have a function, you can break into any of the such form and what automatically terms will come out or come in, okay. So you do not have to, if you have seen numerically, you will get everything correct. This is the way I am explaining you how to do this, okay. Okay. So having shown you this transfer function, I have done this, I am not going to solve it fully, but just to give you some idea on that. So we, one can see tau s, which is essentially rs plus rp into cs, is called open circuit time constant. Is that word, why it is open circuit, what does it mean? 1 upon CPW is infinite, that is the impedance at the output from the capacitance P is open, much larger. So where it can occur, assuming CPs and CS are equal values and not very different, where it can occur, at higher frequency or lower frequency? Much lower frequency, 1 upon CPW will be much higher. Whereas if you see the other time constant, which is RS plus this comparatively, so this, as I say, is called open circuit time constant. By similar logic, we can say tau s represent time constant associated with CS, and the is called short circuit time constant. Sorry, tau s is also called short circuit time constant. Why it was called short circuit? If you short circuit the output and see what is the time constant, it is RSCS related only. So it is related time constant only to RS and only to capacitance CS and not to the CP. So this fact that I can define, similarly tau p is called short circuit, I wrote it correctly and then in hurry I said something wrong. Similarly, by similar argument, I can say tau p is called short circuit constant because at that time the series capacitance I want to short. So where this can occur? Very, very high frequency. Is that clear to you? 1 upon CS omega will become close to 0 only when omega is very high. Omega is very high. So what does, do you get now two separate frequencies from this frequencies? One is very, very low frequency, other is very high frequencies. So one can see if they represent some way the poles, the one pole is very close to zero side, the other pole is very far away from this other side, it is going towards infinite side as well. Is that clear to you? So whenever there is this capacitors available, depending on of course the value of CS and RP and the frequency RS RP frequency, one of the pole may be dominant over other. Which is the dominant will come from here? 1 upon tau p will decide or 1 upon tau s? I just said, you know, if s is infinite, only then this will start dominating, this will short circuit. That means the pole which is decided by much higher frequency, the other term dominates. At much lower frequency, CP is going away, it is only CS which is dominating. Is that correct? So one can say the poles and zeros are normally not at same value, they will automatically get split. This is called splitting of poles. What is it called? Splitting of poles. This is a theory I am trying to, why I brought this circuit. So another technique which I am going to use by proper choice of RS, RP, CS, CP, what can I do? Say initially, let us say some simple figure I can draw again for the same thing which I am doing again and again. Let us say on a step, I'll come back to it. This is my omega p1 and this is omega p2. This is dominant, this is lower, this is low and this is high. But I can change the both side. What can I do? I can bring this on this side and can bring this on this side. I may actually bring them together, or I can also shift the first pole towards lower side, a second pole, and first pole I may shift out. This is called pole splitting. I can actually decide which pole is dominant for me. Is that correct? How do I do that? By proper choice of R's and C's. This is another method what we will see later, of a stability of a amplifier can be achieved by splitting poles. Okay. One method, what did I say? Nulling something. The other way I use splits. Okay. And how do I split? By varying the values of typical RC networks which I put there, so that I can change my pole positions. Is that correct? So these two techniques, there is another one will come when you finally. So is that technically you understood that these are not constant per se. For a given circuit in analysis, we will just solve it, whatever values come. But in real life, if someone asks me, no, I want here, then I will think, what should I do now additionally that I can do what he is asking for? So to do this, this is called design. What is design? The customer tells me I want this and I am asked to design for him. But to design, I must know what should I do that I can meet his specs. Okay. So our course is all the time talking about analysis, but you must be remembering every time that this is not analysis interesting course, and we are not doing for the sake of interest alone, because tomorrow you may be designers and you must know how to design. So you must know which way one can design to get the specs someone is asking, and specs will not be your hand because someone else will tell you, I want this. Okay. So a priori you must know, okay, this is what I am grading, but he wants this. So what should I do? I have learned, one professor taught me like this, I use this technique and let us see what happens. Okay. This is what is all about in real life. Okay. No one actually tells you to solve problems in the exams as we did here in the real industry anytime. But they will come, oh, this product will be marketed, this is the date at which market value is highest, so please put this product in this time. Then you are told, this is what I want. Okay. And that time, of course, this you will do in graduation or PhD, much more detailed way. But right now, to bring you why we are doing it, you know, few years ago, everyone used to ask me, sir, itna analysis lamba lamba karte kyun? So I am now trying to, every class I am now telling, no, it has a relevance in the end of your career, at the start of your career, because there at that time, I will not be there. Books will only give analysis. Okay. So you can see my, even the book which part I am, even it is 400, 500 pages. Every time you cannot carry 2-3 books everywhere. At that time only this helps. Okay. And therefore the tricks I am explaining. Okay. Yes. Because that will be very small. Yeah, but that is the, that means that will start dominating. 1 upon RC of that will start dominating. Smaller the value. Okay, 1 upon RC is smaller, is the first time gain will start falling, the amplitude will start, that is called the dominant pole. Is that clear? No, I would not say it is 0. 0 and infinite are the extreme values. There will be a finite value of CSS also, there will be a finite value of CPP also. Okay, so it is a way, it still will be a ratio, but which one will dominate numerically by magnitude? Is that clear? You do not get that word 0 or infinite as the actual values, because then there is no system left there. Is that clear? That is why many time I show you an arrow to you tending to infinity, okay, tending to 0. Okay. Because otherwise if it is shorted and open, then there is no component there, what to show on that? Okay. Is that clear? Okay. Having told you, if I show you this two frequencies which I just talked, one is called FL 1 upon 2 pi tau s, the other is called FH 1 upon 2 pi tau p. The first one, since being lower, it is called the lower corner frequency. FH is called the upper corner frequency or higher corner frequency. And if I plot the gain versus frequency by Bode's technique, we are not plotted full Bode right now. I figured out what are the corner frequencies. So one at here, one at here. In between, we say the value of V0 Vs is constant. Below FL, the gain will fall. Beyond FH, also gain will fall. V0 by gain means V0 by gain, both sides it will fall. So what is this frequency from FL to FH should be called, where V0 Vs is constant, is called midband, or essentially the bandwidth, or essentially called the bandwidth. In most cases, FL may be very small, close to say 1 hertz or 10 hertz. Is that clear? In many cases, the lower cutoff frequency may be as low as few hertz. Okay. At that time, FH itself is your bandwidth, because FH 100 megahertz minus 10 hertz is as much as 100 megahertz. Is that clear? 100 megahertz minus 10 hertz is as much as 100 megahertz. So if these values are very small, then the normal bandwidth is FH value. Now can you think little more from this kind of figure which I have drawn? You can see from here, if I have a network from anything below FL, the gain is falling sharply, 20 dB per decade. Okay. And any just forget about FH right now, anything ahead, the gain is higher constant. So what is the equivalent I could say again? Maybe we use fresh paper. What I am saying, I have two functions I am now drawing. This is my FL, okay, this is gain versus frequency. So below FL, gain is very small or 0 I made, step function kind, and beyond FL, it is large and constant. By same argument, up to FH, gain is constant, and below, beyond FH, gain is 0. So can you think what is it, what is this actually doing? I have a circuit, I do not know what is, it has a many frequencies F1, F2, Fn, okay. What it will do at the output, from input to output, if it passes through this, it will not allow frequency below FL, okay. So which, what are the frequency it is passing? Higher frequency. So it is called high pass filter, it is called high pass filter. What is this? Up to FH, it will pass all the in frequency as the gain, and beyond FH, it will not allow any this. So it is a low pass filter. So this is high pass filter and this is low pass filter. Can you think two filters out of this before we go to solving? Two more filters from the same figures can be created. What will be band pass? This is what was the band pass. This is essentially your band pass. Okay. From FL to FH is the band in which this is there, beyond that roughly it is 0, 0. Okay. So the band pass filter has something like this, gain F1 and F2. So it is F2 minus F1 is the band in which it is passing, the rest all frequencies. So what will be the fourth one? It is called band reject. So what should be done there? You can see same combinations now I will fit. Okay. I would say one is here. Which one will be this filter? This is HP. This is LP. The only thing is, yeah, ulta kiya hai na maine. LP ko aage laya aur HP ko piche liya. Ab is frequency ke andar band reject ho gaya. See, ye FH jo tha, usko idhar laya, is FL ko aage sarkaya. That is, FL is larger than FH. I told you by circuit I can change FL and FH value. Here FL is smaller than FH. Here FL is smaller than, sorry, F1, F2 is same FLHS. However, here by design I made FL higher than FH. Is that correct? So in between the frequency now, what is it, gain is how much, or signal is 0. So this is called low pass, high pass, this is low pass, sorry, low pass is here first and high pass is ahead, and this is called band pass, this is called band reject. Is that correct? So from the same low pass, band pass, high pass theory, by adjusting time constants, I can create 4 filters: low pass, high pass, band reject. Okay. All that I have to adjust is the value of FL and FH, and they are functions of what? R and C. So by proper choice of network values, I will be able to design any filter which will be of kind which you are looking for. I will not give an answer, but just think, where do you think this will be useful? एक और फिल्टर है ये जरा इंटरेस्टिंग है. आई ब्रिंग एफ वन एफ एल एफ एच वेरी क्लोज. ओके, आई ब्रिंग एफ एल एफ एच वेरी क्लोज, मे बी हियर. सो आई हैव ट्रांसफर फंक्शन वर्सेस वेरी वेरी क्लोज फिल्टर. व्हाट दिस फिल्टर शुड बी कॉल्ड? नॉच फिल्टर. So in all of this game, what is important? What is that we are talking? Adjust your transfer function values with R and C, and you can create all kinds of filter you are looking for. Is that correct? There is another filter which we'll study properly. It's something like this. What is it called? All pass. Now question arises, why such a filter is required at all? Okay, is that clear? All pass, okay. All frequency passes, still we put that filter. So I'm filter, I'm right now, I'm not talking of, I'm only saying network, I have no gains right now, I'm only talking transfer function v0 by vn. There is no amplifier, there is no transistor, right? Amplification can only come if there is an active device. In this, anywhere did I show you any transistor? No, these are only transfer functions. Passive networks, what are these? Passive networks. Along with them, we may put the amplifiers or something to get something more out of these filters, because you need driving, you need many things. But basically, filter has nothing to do with active device. We can always create a filter using passive networks. This is also required, all pass. Something we will show you in the using an op-amp, we do need an all pass filter. Okay. In op-amp circuit, sometimes we need all pass, but still we want there. Okay. Still we want that to be there. So is that clear? Filter theory, filter does not get, basically it's only RC network combinations which can allow certain frequency signal to pass and certain other frequency signal not to pass, okay, or whichever combination of the two. This is the technique. Again, why I'm doing it, this is a technique, I may use it later in my filters, okay. So I just told you today itself that all these tricks I use in actual circuit theory, anywhere I'll use, I'll just follow this. Okay, this I have to adjust, I'll put. So next time if I show you some network, I say this is a low pass, don't ask me why. I told you how it will be low pass. Is that clear? Right now I show you how it works as a low pass, high pass, band pass, band reject. Is that okay? So something, this basic thinking which I thought, I hope that network theory people should have done that. Okay. So at least my course, since I need this later, so I don't want to miss it later. So suddenly say low pass kaise hai? तो आज बता दिया कि ये ऐसा क्यों होता है, क्योंकि फिल्टर्स जो हम बनाएंगे सिर्फ पैसिव नहीं होंगे, उनको बोलते हैं एक्टिव फिल्टर्स. दैट मींस देयर विल बी ट्रांजिस्टर्स और ओपैम्स और सम एक्टिव डिवाइस विल बी देयर. ओके, नॉट दैट विदाउट देम वी विल डू इट, बट बेसिक नेटवर्क इज ए फिल्टर. फिल्टर मीन्स समथिंग इज पास, समथिंग इज नॉट पास, इज फिल्टर. ओके, लेट्स रीविजिट. आई हैव ए नॉर्मल एम्पलीफायर except CC, rest is same which I have discussed. There is an input capacitance Cin, there is an output capacitance CL. Okay, this is a series resistance of the source, there is a load resistance RD, okay, which is the drain resistance RD, and this is an unless and otherwise it is NMOS transistor. Okay. Have you seen what is the circuit? First forget about CC, the all other is a standard amplifier. Okay. And now I add a capacitance between output and input. What is the output point? This drain point. What is the input point? This is the gate point. So I introduced a capacitor between drain and gate. What should be called? Feedback gate, drain to gate, I have connected now. Okay. Now this word is why I brought this again. You can see there are two ways the signal can go. Which are the two ways signal can go from drain and gate? It may go from gate to the drain, then it is called feed forward. What is it called? Feed forward. If the signal goes from here like this, it is called feed forward. But if the signal returns through the same path to the gate, it is called feedback. Is that correct? But capacitor to dono side kar sakte hai. So how do we in real life? We will prefer feed forward be stopped, okay, and feed back be allowed. Okay, what is the trick we are going to play later? I want to reduce feed forward problems, because feed forward is a big problem, we will show you, and I may allow feedback to occur. Is that clear? So, but in real this circuit, don't you see that the signal can go this way or it can come this way? Who can stop it? Okay. Now, who can only stop it? Provided this voltages are such that signal can go from one side to the other only. Is that clear to you? Is that clear to you? If there is this potential is smaller, then this may go, this will go. So we must now look for the potentials at the two ends so that signal can go either way only. Is that clear? This is the trick again we are going to play. Please remember, between two nodes signal can go from 1 to 2 or 2 to 1, feed forward, feed back, either is possible. And as I say, if there is a feed forward, what is the problem we just showed? Okay, we can say right now by associated time constant, one of the poles at the input, okay, without CC is 1 upon RS Cin. So what is the trick I am now showing you? Quick poles, they may not be accurate ones. If CC is not there, what is the time constant at the input? RS Cin. So that it should give a one pole. Okay, at the input side. Okay. Now I have a problem which I say there is a famous theorem which is called Miller's theorem. Okay, this is a famous theorem which is called Miller's theorem. It is essentially says if you have a two port network and on the one of them is the impedance Z, okay, then this Z can be split into, and let us say what is the input. If your input signal is V1, at the output you have a signal AV1 minus AV1. Okay. It could be plus AV1 also, it does not matter, but AV1. Okay. A is the gain function. If this is your two port network, can you think where it can be? Abhi jo dikhaya circuit usme ye hai, isliye I am using this. You have a signal V1, at the output you have amplified signal AV1. And in between output and input there is an impedance Z. Is that okay? It can be capacitance, it can be resistor, it can be RC together, or it can be even inductance, okay, or it can be LCR, anything Z. Okay. According to Miller's theorem, what is Miller is saying? This could be split into a pi kind of circuit, non-pi kind of circuit, two port kind separation. The first component Z1 is essentially equal to 1 minus A times Z. That is, this Z can be split at the input side as 1 minus A into Z, and A is minus, please take it, A is minus. So it is 1 plus A magnitude wise, is that correct? And if A is large, you can even neglect 1. So it is gain times the Z is seen as the input. Please remember where it is. Between output and input you have an impedance Z, so it will reflect at the input side as gain times that value. Please remember this minus is plus, actually A is minus, so 1 plus A have magnitude wise. Is that clear? A is minus, so 1 minus A is 1 plus magnitude wise A. Okay. So this is larger or smaller? A is larger, is a gain function. So larger than at least 10, 20, 100 times. Okay. So this impedance at the input will come much larger at the input side. However, if you see equivalent on the right side of, that is at the output side, this Z2 is A upon this minus, I have removed now. A is positive, 1 minus A is 1 plus A. Both minus now. A is minus. A is minus. No, no. A is positive here means this with minus A is the gain. A is equal to minus V2 by V1. Assume the there is a phase shift in all transistors. Okay. This minus sign is only taken care for opposite sign. V0 is minus GMR. Is that correct? So it is that minus. A is positive, but that is the, so that is what I say. Okay. If you feel so much worried, okay. Bas. Ab theek hai. A is positive. Is that okay now? So essentially it is gain times the Z will reflect at the input, but gain upon 1 plus A is how much? 1, almost 1. That way into Z will be reflected at the output. This is called Miller's theorem. So any such network connecting between output and input can be split into part in the input, part at the output. Please remember the condition of Miller's theorem, and if that is not true, then the Miller's theorem is not. How can I derive this? Can you do me? How can I derive this? Don't use these values. This is Z1, this is Z2. You evaluate from, write an equation for this and find what will be impedance seen here and what will be impedance here, equate it and you will get this expression. Kirchhoff law lagaya maine. Okay. Nahi to karke dekho, maine bhi kiya hai, so I got. Please try it. Okay, the most important part in Miller's theorem, which most books avoid telling you, is this. The Miller's theorem is only and only valid only and only if there are two paths from input to the output. Is that correct? Miller's theorem is only valid if there are two paths from input to the output. If there are no two paths, the Miller's theorem, that means if this is not A times something which I showed, V1 and V2, this cannot be split. Is that clear? If this A is because of the transfer function of the some active device, if there is no such active device sitting there, or there are no such two paths created there, the Miller's theorem is invalid. So what I am saying, don't say this is V1, this is V2, so this will be split. This is not possible. Okay. So what is the equivalence I am asking for Miller's to be valid? There should be a gain term or some function through which input can go, one path, and this is the other feedback path or feed forward path. Is that clear to you? So if you have a two paths only, and then the Miller split is allowed. Is this condition clear to you? If this kind of circuit is not possible in this, that's why A, I have put it here indirectly. Is that correct? That A means essentially gain function coming from here. If that doesn't exist, no such split is possible. This theory, if you will, someday I will give you some 1 hour lecture on Miller. You know. So this is only nutshell I brought you. Actually, theory is very interesting, longish enough to prove my all points. Right now I am assuming something and saying it is proved, but I can show you without assuming also. Okay. So some other day. So is the Miller theorem clear? So if you look at my, this is what I am going to use very often. So can you see for where I can use now Miller's theorem, for which component? Yes, which component I can use Miller theorem? CC, output to input is the only component is CC. How many paths you can see from here? One through here, one through here. Is that clear? So there are two paths available, and that's why CC could be split now. Is that correct? Yeah, so CC is actually come to equivalent circuit. Yeah, your point of view is understood, but let us wait few seconds. Okay. One is through transistor, gate to drain, GMVGS, minus GMVGS. Ek current to transistor de raha hai na. गेट से गेट में VGS लगाया तब ड्रेन करंट माइनस टाइम्स आया ना उधर, एक पाथ मिला, दूसरा एक्सटर्नल पाथ दिया जो कैपेसिटर से जोड़ रखा है। तो दो पाथ की थ्योरी जो बोली वो दिखी कि ना यही मिरर लग सकता है। यदि इसको हटा लिया, ट्रांजिस्टर वहां से हटा लिया तो देर इज नो मिरर थ्योरम। दिस फैक्ट हैज टू बी अंडरस्टूड, यू कैनॉट स्प्लिट अदरवाइज, इज दैट क्लियर? सो ओनली वेन यू सी सच थिंग्स then you say I split is possible, okay? Yeah, it always corresponds to external feedback. In transistor, even internal feedback is always there, which is the component which is always connected between gate and drain? CGD. So that is also there, but this CC I put it additional to CGD, so add CGD to CC. So total capacitance between drain and gate is CC, externally put by me, okay? So I have now two paths. One the transistor, other through CC, is that correct? And this will give me again with a phase of minus 180 degree, is that clear? And this will give another one. So I am now looking into this situation, and therefore I can say now CC is splittable. What is the amplifier gain in our case? Just look at it, leaving all capacitances, what is the amplifier gain? Bina kuch soche bolo na, is amplifier ka gain kitna hota hai? R0 is infinite मान लिया या बहुत ज्यादा है, तो GMRD minus GMRD parallel R0 if you wish, so the gain of this amplifier is minus GMRD. Please remember R0 is parallel with that, but since RDs are much smaller normally, I leave R0s, but in real life what should you write? RD parallel R0, okay. So it is minus GMRD is the gain, okay. So what is this value I got? That minus a word which you are seeing is this GMRD is the value which I got for the gain function, okay. So can I now write an equivalent circuit using, I know the gain, I know CC, so I can now write an equivalent circuit. What I said so far is the exactly what I wrote, okay. There is no difference in what I said, okay. Is that okay? So Miller's theorem is valid for our case. So at the node 1, that is at the input side, what will be the capacitance seen now? One is seen one, please look at your circuit, what is the first capacitance I have given? Input capacitance of a transistor, seen one, so that exists as it is. Please, what are the node 1 I am talking? The gate terminal I call node 1, the drain terminal I call node 2, okay. So first is seen one. And shunted by it, how much is the capacitance will be? 1 minus minus GMRD times CC, or 1 plus GMRD times CC plus Cn 1 is actually the input capacity. Is it becoming larger or smaller? Earlier Cn may be order of say 0.1 puff, how much? 0.1 or even less than that, femtofarad, maybe 10 to 50 femtofarads. Let us say GMRD is 100. Okay, let us say CC is 0.1 puff, so how much I am? 10 puff I am adding to some femtofarads, how much initial capacitance I have? Few femtofarads in one, I have added 100 times CC, even if it is 0.1 puff I say, or 100 femtofarads, even then it will add now tens of puffs. So what is the way value capacitance has increased? Enormously. If there is a resistance here per se equivalent something, what will be the time constant, will increase or decrease? Increase. So the 1 upon time constant will increase or decrease? Decrease, is that correct? Because larger 1 upon RC is larger, 1 upon RC is smaller. So abhi ye laga ga ki ye just feedback mein capacitance if you put, the pole on the input side will go lower value or higher value, which side it will move? C has increased, 1 upon RC C has increased, so P will become lower value. So the first pole has, if I would not have put this, let us say there is no CC, where would have been my pole? R into C in 1. If I put a CC, where would the pole shifted? 100 times on the left, or whatever size, values actually are. Is that correct? Left means smaller. Is that correct? So do you see that I am now tailoring my FL FH values by just putting a CC there? I have brought down one pole to the very left side. Okay. How much I can do it? That will be decided by which values? By the GMs, by the RDs, and by the CC I connect. Generally, I may not play too much on GMRD. Why I will not play too much on GMRD? Because that's the gain. I don't want to play too much on gain. So I will only change the value of CC. So CC may tell me where should I put my pole. Please remember, scene 1 will be very small compared to CC 1 plus this time CC. So essentially, it is the CC which may decide the pole at the input. Is that correct? Unless, of course, there are additional capacitances available at scene 1. Is that point clear? CN1 is larger than, you may see how much is parallel, total sum of that. But in case it is only CGD, CGS, then that may be smaller than 1 plus GMRD times CC. Okay. And in that case, we say CC may now start deciding the pole at the input side. Is that correct? So have I tailored it? I changed it. This is what design is all about. I tailor it. I say, okay, where chahiye? Idhar? Or dal do. Okay. See the next side, at the output side. There is a load capacitance, and how much is the capacitance it will reflect at the output? I said A upon 1 plus A means 1 only. So it is CC only. So the output capacitance is CL plus CC. So the second pole will be 1 plus RD times CL plus CC. Please remember, 1 plus GMRD times CC is very large, but CC may not be that large, that large. So its load may be external, I do not know, it may be large also. Is that clear? So this pole will be generally smaller or larger than the earlier P1. CL and CC will be comparatively smaller, some of them. Is that clear? RD is typically few kilo ohms, okay, R tens of kilo ohms, RS is in few hundreds of ohms there. C's are increasing there. So which pole is earlier than the second one? P1 is earlier or P2 is earlier? P1 is much earlier compared to P2. This, did you see I split it? So I moved P2 far away, or I brought P1 away from the P2. Is that clear? If I do not put CC, then what will happen? This CL and CN may be opposite. Please tell it what can happen. If C1 is comparatively smaller value, RCN may be larger, 1 upon RCN may be larger compared to 1 upon RDCC CL. So then what will happen? The output pole may start dominating over input pole. Now what did I do? I made input pole dominate over the output pole by putting CC. Is that I remove the CC, then it may possible value of CL and RD are such that this pole may come earlier than RSCN1. Okay. In that we say, okay, output pole is dominant now than the input one. But by putting a CC, what did I confirm you? That the input pole will always be dominant over the output poles. Is that clear? So CC is going to decide where should I have my bandwidth. Is that correct? Why it is called bandwidth point? Because beyond that, the gain will start falling 20 dB down. Pole means gain will start 20 dB down. So this is the value. Is that clear? Your bandwidth I am controlling through what? CC. External capacitance, I am controlling it now. Is that clear? These are the tricks which all amplifier designers use. Where do I put my pole? Okay. Is that correct? See, pole 1 is 1 upon RS times Cin. Cin I have increased by CC because gain times CC is appearing. RS is, let us say, 100 ohms. And this is, say, gain is high enough, GMRD times CC is also high enough. So this value may be, let us say, gets to, say, 1 kilohertz, okay. This is, say, 10 kilo ohms, and this is, CL is equal to something like this, and this goes to, let us say, 10 kilohertz, sorry, because of RDR, this combination. So this pole has started dominating, which is this 1/10 of this. But if this scene is scene 1 only, okay, which is 100 times less than that, and RS is smaller, then the P1 may become larger than the P2, in which case I would say output pole may dominate. But by putting CC, I guaranteedly said something that the input pole will dominate. Is that clear to you? So by, why I did not want to try on the output side, can you tell me why? Because this CL is not known to me many times, so I do not know what bandwidth I will use. Is that clear to you? Why I am always looking at the other side? Is that point clear? Because CL is something unknown to me. In my analysis, I put some value, okay. But in real life, where it will get connected, I have no idea, okay. And then that should not decide my bandwidth. Is that correct? Some unknown quantity where my this amplifier is going to drive should not decide where my bandwidth is. So by putting CC, what did I do? I decided my bandwidth independent of what is ahead. Is that clear to you? This is called what you want, can you get without the output telling us what I should do. But in analysis, we need not do all that. We just calculate for all capacitance, all resistance, what RCs we get and find which is higher or which is low. We say, okay, sir, yaha pehla hai, phir dusra hai, ya teesra hai. Is that clear? So in analysis, which we will do one, you need not worry all this which I am telling you. Why I am telling you all these tricks? Because this is how I will design. Is that clear? CC designs the bandwidth, which is external. External means I am putting it, load I do not know, but this amplifier I am designing. So I am adjusting CC value for my bandwidth. The assumption is CL will not be so small or something which will start. That may still happen otherwise then. So some conditions I must meet, but generally if the gains are larger and CCs we put around 1 puff, 0.1 puff to 1 puff, this will always on the left side, okay, input pole will dominate. But please do not take it that every time input pole will dominate over output poles, is that correct? You have to calculate and find, but by trick, by this roughly it will always occur for general techniques. Is that okay? This tricks I am telling you because I have figured out over the years that people always feel that why do we do so much of this. So I am now explaining why we do that. Is that correct? So we will solve a circuit in which this has nothing to do with actual knowing where the poles are. What we will do is we will have a network, we will find all RCs and calculate whichever is omega 1, omega 2, omega 3. Then we may substitute the given values and find, oh, where is omega 1, where is omega 2, where is omega 3. Is that clear? So in real analysis, we are damn bothered which dominates, but in design, I know, want to know where I control myself. Last but not the least, before we go, yes, okay, I made a mistake, he may be right, put Y, okay, do not say Z, because I think he was right, I did not want to that time agree, it is an admittance, essentially capacity is an admittance value. Okay, so you are very good. Thank you for correcting me. Okay. Z by Y. Okay. Sorry, that Z is a for R and C, R and L. Y is for admittance. Because it is one upon that, na? So I made a mistake. Thank you very much. Okay. Okay. There is another important issue. We have seen poles so far. Okay. Now people say, why should 0 occur? What is the transfer function 0 means? At the output, V0 should go to 0. Where is the 0 in a transfer function? When the output goes to 0. Now, output can only go to 0 if there are two signals opposite phase and equal magnitude. Ek aisa current hai, ek usi node pe opposite current hai aur equal hai, to is node pe the potential 0 kar diya. Yadi same two paths opposite polarity gives the same magnitude, then I will create output 0. Is that correct? I into R, both cancels. Minus IR plus IR. R1, R2 may be different, but I1 into R and I2 into R2, opposite fade, R1, R2 may decide, they may cancel at some point. Is that clear? This is exactly what zeros are all about. Just now I showed you there are two paths equivalently, we say. One is the path through a transistor, let us say an input V in 2, and the other path is let us say an input V in 1, which actually V in 1 are both are same, but even if they are different I do not care, the other path is this. Yeh kaun sa problem dikha raha hu main abhi? फीड फॉरवर्ड, आउटपुट पर दो पाथ मिल रहे हैं मुझे, एक एक सिग्नल से सीसी के तरफ से आ रहा है, दूसरा ट्रांजिस्टर के अंदर से आ रहा है, जीएम टाइम्स आ रहा है। बट ट्रांजिस्टर ऑलवेज गिव मी हाउ मच फेज शिफ्ट, माइनस मीन 180 डिग्री शिफ्ट, सो दिस इज ऑलवेज गिविंग मी 180 शिफ्ट, दिस इज डायरेक्ट, इज दैट करेक्ट? इफ द वैल्यूज ऑफ IR for here and IR from this are such that at this potential output is balanced because of this or because of this, then we may say because they are opposite polarity, there is a possibility of those values cancelling each other. Is that point clear? Ek se ek path hai, ek dusra 180 out of path hai, in dono ka value same nikal gaya opposite polarity mein. So the net AC current may be zero for that. Is that clear? So V zero will become zero. So output will become go to zero. Is that now clear why zero can occur? You have created a CC and you say, okay, I shifted the poles. You did very great thinking, isn't it? When I put a CC, I was thinking, oh, great! Look, I shifted poles and all that. But this problem is suddenly seen by me now. I say, Baba, if such magnitudes occur, then I may actually get a zero. Is that clear? And zero means 20 dB per decade gain enhancement. Pole means 20 dB per decade going down. Now, where is this zero and where is this pole? If that occurs at the same first frequency, then nothing has happened. Actually, it has cancelled each other. So now I have to start looking into where this zero falls. Is that clear? Where this zero is occurring? At what value of R, C, and GM this can occur? Is that correct? What value of these three zero can occur? And if that those values till the dominant pole is omega p 1, fine. Otherwise, I'll have to say, "Are yeah, then I am not gaining anything." Is that clear? So. This was a pole, and at the same frequency, if the zero starts, okay, same frequency, then this is the pole zero has cancelled each other. So the whole purpose of shifting that pole has lost. Is that clear? You can see then only it will start falling. So the purpose of a zero may not be as good as we think. It may be actually bad. Oh, so V in one, V in two, only to show you two paths. V in can be same. They are same. You connect it here if you wish. V in one is same as V in two. It is only to show you two paths. इसलिए मैंने अलग से दिखाया. Okay. What is saying that sir? ये अलग अलग नहीं, ये same है. Okay. V in नहीं रखो. This is just to show you two paths. Yes, ma'am. No. See this node. As I say, if they are equal, this node and this node are same. That's what I said. You only show path. I have made it separate. What you are asking is correct. If they are same like this, now it's okay. So the point I am trying to say that whenever there is a feedback capacitor between drain and gate, not only you will get a different pole, but you may also land into a zero. Is that correct? There will be a zero associated with this feedback capacitance every time, and those values may actually change your Bode plot anyway. Is that correct? So you thought only pole I can adjust, then you realize that not only pole, but now this zero is also coming. Okay. So in your analysis, you must also figure out where is that zero now. Okay. And how it will come into expression in the numerator? Somewhere term must go to zero. That will be its zero. Is that correct? If that at a given frequency, numerator must become zero. Okay. If that occurs, then we'll say there is a zero present, and the value of that zero and value of the pole you are shifting should not be same. Is that okay? This is what we are. As I say, I am not done so far. Amplifier. अभी इसके बाद है. This is what we want to do. Okay, actually. But all this today we did is general theory. How do I bring zeros, high bang, poles? What do they mean? Okay. Is that okay? So today we only did a general theory. Okay, for poles and zeros. Next time we'll do an amplifier and find poles.